So I'm Anna Stamborski. I get the honor to talk to you all about culture and theology today. I'm a teacher, so obviously we need to start our time together reframing and doing a little activity. So also, like she did, we're going to start with imagining. So the first question I want you all is to imagine the face of your pastor. Whoever it is, imagine their face. Second one I want you to imagine is first three theologians who come to your mind. First three, gut reaction. Who are the first three? For some of us, it's harder than others. First three. And then last question, your favorite worship artist. So who's your favorite worship artist? And so for me, my gut reactions were these faces. And so what we're going to dig into today is when we have these spiritual inputs, when they're homogenous, specifically racially, what does that do to the way in which we view scripture? What does that do to the way in which we view the gospel and we view certain church practices? And so today we're going to dig into white doesn't equal right, the danger in marriage, marrying, our culture and our theology, and steps to broaden our view of the gospel and of God. Shots fired, buckle up. We're going to do great. It's going to be great. And so Peter actually gives us a perfect example of marrying our culture and our theology. This is actually a term coined by Tiffany Merritt Brown. The idea is that what we decide is right or wrong, what we decide is holy or unholy, is not actually based on scripture, but it's based on our own cultural norms. And so the idea of, well, do I think doing a relationship like this, or how do I drink, or even what's the better way to preach or worship, is not based on scripture, but it's based on our own cultural norms. And so Peter actually gives us an awesome example of this in Acts, and it actually deals with food. And so I will read it out for those of you, sorry if you can't read, I'll read it for you. So it says, about noon the following day, as they were on their journey and approaching the city, Peter went up on the roof to pray. He became hungry and wanted something to eat, and while the meal was being prepared, he fell into a trance. He saw heaven opened up and something like a large sheet being let down to earth by its four corners. It contained all kinds of four-footed animals, as well as reptiles and birds. Then a voice told him, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." "Surely not, Lord," Peter replied. "I have never eaten anything impure or unclean." The voice spoke to him a second time, "Do not call anything impure that God has made clean." This happened three times, and immediately the sheet was taken back to heaven. And so for those of us who don't come from a Jewish background, we're probably like, I don't get it, Anna, it's food, whatever. But Peter, first and foremost, we want to acknowledge that Peter was Jewish. And so he had a rich history of following a Jewish culture. And so before Jesus came, there were certain things Jews could and could not eat. And so if we understood this, this would be gut reaction. There is no way he's eating any of this. Based on how he was raised, absolutely not. But Jesus had already come. We have a new covenant. And so there were certain things that Jews no longer had to follow, right? So circumcision was one of them. And God was calling him out on how he had married his culture and his theology and what he thought was right or not right. And so what we see here is that he believes culturally he shouldn't eat these animals, but he has decided that spiritually it would be unholy for him to do that. And so God calls him out on marrying his culture and his theology, and deciding what he thought was holy and not holy was actually based on his culture and not on what God wanted him. And so what I want to acknowledge first is that this can happen to any of us from any culture. Any of us can start to marry our culture and theology, and that can become extremely dangerous when cultural norms become holy and unholy, especially when you project those onto other people groups. But what I do want to argue is having a culture of power and being in the majority culture can be very dangerous because you have the majority. And so what I want to acknowledge is that white does not equal right. In America, we have come, when we say American culture, in my opinion, that's just white culture is masked. And I'll talk further about that. But the idea of mainstream, normal, or standard is really just white culture. And I would also argue that within the church, what we say is mainstream, standard, normal is really just white theology. You can call it Anglo-Saxon, Western European, but I'm going to refer to it just simply as white theology. And so some of you are like, who in the world is this woman talking up here, and where in the world does she come from? So I am from the great state of Wisconsin. I grew up in a white working class, white working class neighborhood outside of Milwaukee. I grew up literally in rich white culture. I thought everyone liked casseroles and camping. That was just what I thought. I went to a majority white church, went to a majority white school, went to a majority white ministry, but God has given me amazing cross-cultural, multicultural experiences in which he has pushed me in my understanding because I had married my culture and my theology. And so I got the chance to study abroad in Mérida, Venezuela. I have had an 8-year-long relationship with a church down in Jarabacoa, Dominican Republic. I did half of my student teaching in Kasese, Uganda. And I got the honor and privilege of learning from and working alongside teachers of color in New York City for a summer. And so God has pushed me continuously to break apart my culture and my theology. And we're going to dig into that. And so we're going to get into the nitty-gritty of what that looks like specifically. For me, I've spent 6 years intentionally reading into this, observing. It's all I read about, but it's been a lifetime of observing differences. And so we have this Venn diagram, and first off, I just want to acknowledge these are vast generalizations. They can't possibly represent everyone's views, the realities. It's way more complicated than this. But for us today, I've simplified it down. And so first, we're going to dig into white American church practices. In general, when it comes to culture, white culture is very individualist, and it's very much the value of the written word. When it comes to scripture, there's a value in academic investigation of scripture, however you want to term academic. And then it's also viewed as neutral and outside the political realm. I don't know how many times growing up, it was like, Jesus didn't care about politics, or we're going to leave that outside of the church. That's what I heard growing up my entire life. Additionally, when it comes to preaching, audience is expected to stay silent. I remember I would sneeze and I thought I would interrupt the entire sermon. Additionally, there is economy of language. So get that sermon done in 30 to 40 minutes and you're good to go. When it comes to worship, a solemn tone is valued and low audience movement. And so my pastor in Madison called it the inner Norwegian, total as still as you could possibly be. And additionally, something that I've personally observed is that when it comes to worship, it's centered around rekindling a relationship with you and God. So God, I just want to feel you more. God, I want to feel your spirit. God, I want you to renew a fire in me. It's God, I just, God, I just, God, I just. A very me action oriented. From what I've observed and read within the Black American church practices, it's much more communal, right? There's a value of oral history as well as the way in which viewing scriptures is value in living out scriptures called to serve the community, as well as a Bible tool, as Bible is used as a tool for liberation. When it comes to preaching, there's a call and response and a full range of emotion. As well as in worship, there's a value of repetition in order to reflect deeper. The audience has a high amount of participation and movement, and that there are themes centered around God's character, his goodness, and his faithfulness. So very much centered around who he is, and I would argue, look at the opposite when it comes to worship. And so for me, growing up in white America, God has pushed me in my experiences when it comes to church. So there was a chunk of time when I went to a Black Baptist church in Madison, Wisconsin, and then immediately the summer after, when I was living in New York, I went to a Black Baptist church, and immediately that fall, I went to a Black Pentecostal church in Uganda. And so I had deeply integrated, in my opinion, how I would say it, I had white theological supremacy. And so when I went to these churches, I was like, why is the pastor so emotional? Why hasn't he talked about the Hebrew? Why is worship so repetitive? Is there nothing else that the worship song could be? And I had married my culture and my theology, but the problem is it was no longer a horizontal comparison, it was a hierarchical comparison in which I thought there was a better way to do church, a more evolved, a holier way to do church, and how dangerous that is. And so we need to acknowledge that how dangerous can it be is when we value one way of doing church over another. And so we're going to dig into 3 examples of how this can play out in everyday life. And so the first one is from Propaganda. He's a hip-hop artist. He talks specifically about his experience in seminary. And so I'm just going to read it off for you. He says, you sit in this white church experience and you're listening and this seems so much more academic. But then you have this conflict in you, especially if you're African-American, to where you're like, I feel like these people understand the Bible, but these people understand the world. And you feel like you got to choose. And since you're not hearing any other voices in your seminary, you don't know. So you're this Black dude that feels like you're losing more and more of your identity every day. And in the back of your brain, you're thinking there's no way that God only spoke to Dutch dudes. And so what we need to realize is, right, like higher education is seen as the apex, the most evolved, the best, whatever there is, the cream of the crop. And if we're only saying that these Western European dudes are the foundation, what does that mean, the foundation of Christianity? What does it say about all the other people groups who have relationships with God? What does that say of who we believe is the better way of doing this? And so I would argue how this affects generally in seminary is it causes this tension, right? If you come up and you're used to white theology, it's totally normal. But if you're not, there's this tension. And I would argue that we all miss out when that's what we say is the foundation of Christianity. Additionally, discipleship. So I went to the University of Wisconsin. Go Badgers. And there was discipleship was just a normal thing of ministry when you were on campus ministries. And so I heard this story from another campus. And so the idea is that you have this discipleship relation. You have this wiser, more holy person who's giving their wisdom to this younger student. And so what we have here is there's this white dude who is a discipler and a Hmong dude. Hmong is a people group from Southeast Asia. And so they're in this discipleship relationship, and you're living life on life, right? But the problem is our white dude had married his culture and his theology. And so they're talking about relationships. And so the Hmong dude was like, yeah, I don't know if I should date this woman. Like, I don't think she would jive well with my family. And the white dude was like, well, that's not a big deal. It's about you, her, she's a believer, and that's it. Number one, realizing the individualist in that comment and the communalist in the Hmong man's opinion. And so what we have here is that it can be a simple statement, but really what it's showing is it's like, I have the better way of doing this. I have the more holy way, right? They're in a discipleship relationship. And so how dangerous that can be when you project your cultural norms onto another person and say, no, that doesn't matter. That's not the right way to do it. It's not the godly way to do it. You're making a big deal out of this. But really it was a cultural difference, but now it's seen as holy and not holy. And then when it comes to prayer, I've read a brilliant book by Dr. Richard Twiss. It's called Rescuing the Gospel from the Cowboys, and it's specifically about the Native American expression of the Jesus way, as he refers to it. And so it's specifically how sweat lodges are used as a way to interact with God on a spiritual level for prayer. And so specifically a quote says, Russell, the man who's talking, commented about how good it felt to be there, the sweat lodge ceremony. It was like coming home, he said. I used to sweat all the time and pray with sage and sweetgrass, pray with my pipe and dance my prayers at powwows. But the church said I had to quit all the stuff because it was of the devil. Jesus was with me during those years, but I always felt a sadness, like a part of me was boxed up in the closet. And so specifically what Dr. Twiss argues is that the people who are most against using traditional Native practices within a Christian space were Native American pastors themselves. And so what I want to also acknowledge is the fact that if we are discipling and if we're evangelizing from our own cultural norms, we're creating disciples in our own image. And so if we've had a majority white group of people evangelizing to Native Americans, it was recreating their own cultural norms. And so the danger behind this is that unconsciously you can view the gospel and scripture through a white lens, no matter your race. And so the danger behind that of saying, well, Native American pastors are the ones saying don't do it, but the problem is what cultural perspective were they coming from and were they trained in scripturally? And some of you are like, what the heck? We live in the Bay. We don't have this as a problem. What are you talking about? We're post-racial utopia over here. Interesting. I've observed differently. And so first I want to argue that multiracial churches does not mean multicultural. And so the idea is just because we have a ton of races in our assemblies does not mean that those cultures are represented on the podium. So looking at your preaching staff, looking at your worship leaders, looking at who has power and authority in that. And if it's not representative of your congregation, I would argue it's not multicultural. And secondly, when you do have people of color in power, do they actually have the agency and authority to create change? And so if they are expected to assimilate to a certain culture, I would argue on the norm is white culture and white church practices, then it's not actually multicultural. And so giving people the agency to actually create change and that certain ways, certain Christian practices are respected across all cultures. And so for me, why I think this is a big deal is Dr. Charles Yu gave an amazing sermon on this about the idea of homogeneity breeds corruption. And the idea of the Tower of Babel was actually destroyed because what they were able to do is they all are of the same culture, they all were of the same language, and so God destroyed that because they were able to exploit scripture in order to exploit others based on their cultural norms. They had no one checking their cultural blind spots. And so the idea is that if we have all of our theologians who come from a similar race, all of our pastors coming from a similar race, all of my worship artists coming from a similar race, there's no way we can check our cultural blind spots. And so we need each other to check each other on our blind spots. I would also say is that we miss out. Like, I miss out on different perspectives of God. My soul misses out. I am lacking. It's not like this social justice thing that I need to push onto other people. My soul misses out. And so the bottom line is we miss out on different facets of who God is in the gospel when we value one culture over another. And so this happened to me when I moved to the Bay, and it was the hardest year of my life. And no Hillsong, no Elevation Worship, no Bethel music was able to hit that point of need of knowing God was sovereign like gospel music did for me. I kid you not. And so it was like if I didn't have that openness about other cultures, I would have missed out myself. And so recommendations, I realize my time is up, but knowing that this is what heaven's going to look like, it's not going to be vanilla or whatever color you are, and so we want to bring that now. And so I have a couple of recommendations. Sorry, I'm going to have to flip through these quick. Number one, listen to different music. Have pastors who aren't your same race read books from different authors, and heed to the leadership of people of color in your staff. And then lastly, killer books, read them. I'd highly recommend them. Thanks for listening.
Thanks, Anna.